Oh, I'm so glad you got to hear Tom and Mary's story. They came last night because they were a little nervous about seeing it in the big crowd. Their story. I love that story for many reasons. One is I know Tom and Mary well, and I love them, and it's fun to share with all of you, because in a church our size, with different campuses and venues for worship, we don't always get to know each other or hear the stories that God is doing, and it's just fun to share that with you. And I love that story in particular because there's so many, like when she said, "Oh my goodness, we're idiots. We have a church," you know. And when she said, just pay attention to what God's doing in your life, because put him in the driver's seat. And I've seen that happen in their life over the years. And Tom will tell you, it's not just that we found a church that inspires us, it's that our kids' lives have been changed. Generations have been impacted, and their families will be different because of it. And that's really what we're about, reaching people, seeing the gospel transform their lives and their families' lives and for generations. That's what we're doing here. In 1997, Apple, then the Apple Computers Incorporated, had an ad campaign called Think Different. Some of you might remember that. And there was a famous line from a commercial, which most people think Steve Jobs wrote, but he didn't. It's called The Crazy Ones. Let me read it for you. Here's to the crazy ones, the misfits, the rebels, the troublemakers, the round pegs and the square holes, the ones who see things differently. You can quote them, disagree with them, glorify them, or vilify them. But the only thing you can't do is ignore them, because they change things. They push the human race forward. And while some may see them as the crazy ones, we see genius, because the people who are crazy enough to think they can change the world are the ones who do. That was written by a Los Angeles ad executive named Robert Stiltonen, but Steve Jobs claimed it. Anyway. I saw it on a t-shirt, and Pastor Brian and I were talking about this, that last line. The people who are crazy enough to think they can change the world are the ones who do. I started thinking about that. Can people change the world, really? Can individual people change the world? Well, if you think about history, we'd have to say yes, wouldn't we? I mean, there have been individuals who have changed the world. Martin Luther changed the world. Martin Luther King Jr. impacted the world. William Wilberforce, Rosa Parks, Sir Isaac Newton. And of course, one Clive Staples Lewis has deeply impacted the world. We could make a long list of people who have had profound impact on world history, in economics, in politics, in education, in government, in society, in literature, in art, in music. What about me? What about you? Am I crazy enough to think I could change the world? Does that sound just like, you know, kind of over-the-top talk? Could you change the world? What about us? What about the church? What about this church? Is it ridiculous to think we could change the world? Is that just, you know, I mean, let's not get crazy here. With apologies to Steve Jobs and Apple, it is people who take the gospel seriously, churches who take seriously the call of the gospel that really change the world in a lasting way. We say all the time around here, because we believe it's true, that the gospel transforms lives, and the transformed lives impact the world. You saw little bits and pieces of that transformation and impact in Tom and Mary Rogers' story. It is churches that are crazy enough to believe that the gospel is real, that it really does transform people, that change the world. Why would you want to be part of a church that didn't believe this? I think some people do want to be part of a church that doesn't believe this. Some people want to come to church and keep religion in its place. I want to be informed and inspired in the sermon. I want the music to be not terrible. You know, I want stuff for my kids, and I want to go home feeling good about myself, but let's not get crazy. No, let's get crazy. Seriously. Why? I don't want to be part of a church that doesn't believe deep in our heart, not because we're super smart or we're industrious or we have the right ideas, but because we take the gospel seriously. That this is not just talk, that God really can forgive your sin, redeem your life, give you a new identity, hope, and purpose, and then collectively call these redeemed people together to change the world, starting with their own lives right where they live. Let me ask you a couple questions you can answer by showing your hands. How many of you would say that your relationship with Jesus Christ began here as a part of FBCG? Show of hands. Praise God for that. Praise God for what he did in your life. How many of you would say that it might have started somewhere else, but it really grew to be serious, and you began to really grow in your faith here at FBCG? Show of hands. I praise God for that. How many of you would say that you came here because somebody reached out to you, invited you? Show of hands. Now, one more question. How many of you would say that you know somebody in your life who needs gospel transformation right now? Show of hands. All right? Maybe some of you are going, I do. Put those questions together in your mind. What God has done, what he is doing, and what he will do in our midst. That's how the gospel works. One city, one neighborhood, one family, one life at a time. That's our series we've been in the last 3 weeks. Now this is the fourth week, Neighborhood Impact. Let me give you a quick review of what we've talked about. First, we talked about gospel transformation, all wrapped up in the story of the Good Samaritan that Jesus told, meaning it begins with our own heart. It's not just an obligation to go out and try hard to be a good person. It begins by recognizing what Christ has done for you. You begin to be transformed, and that then leads to gospel compassion, meaning when your heart is changed, you see people differently. You feel differently about the world and your role in it. And that, we talked last week, leads to gospel generosity. You not only see yourself and other people differently, you see your stuff differently. You see all that you have is you're not an owner, but you're a steward that God has given you this, and you have an opportunity to make a difference with your very life and all that you have. And this morning, we're talking about gospel impact. What does a transformed, compassionate, generous life look like and produce impact in the world? Your life should make a difference, should make an impact. Let's read the story again we've been looking at, Luke chapter 10, verses 30 through 37. And again, before we read the story Jesus told, let me give you the background in case you haven't been with us. Jesus is asked a question by a religious expert. What must I do to inherit eternal life? And Jesus says, basically, you're the expert, you tell me. And the man's answer is the perfect answer. He says, to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind and all your strength, and to love your neighbor as yourself. Jesus says, right. And the man then realizes who can live up to that impossible standard, wanting to justify himself. He says, but who is my neighbor? Which is the profound question we've been unpacking. And this is Jesus' answer to that question, who is my neighbor? Beginning with verse 30, Luke 10, verse 30. Jesus replied, a man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho, and he fell among robbers who stripped him and beat him and departed, leaving him half dead. Now by chance, a priest was going down that road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. So likewise, a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, as he journeyed, came to where he was, and when he saw him, he had compassion. He went to him, bound up his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. Then he set him on his own animal and brought him to an inn and took care of him. And the next day he took out 2 denarii and gave him to the innkeeper, saying, take care of him, and whatever more you spend, I'll repay you when I come back. Which of these three do you think proved to be neighbor to the man who fell among the robbers? He said, the one who showed him mercy. And Jesus said to him, you go and do likewise. Every life has an impact one way or the other. Every life impacts somebody. The question for us is, what kind of impact do you want your life to have? And we begin by asking, what kind of impact has God made in my life? That's the heart of the story. You'll remember, it's not just don't be like the priest, don't be like the Levite, be like the good Samaritan. The reality of the story is, you first need to see yourself as the half-dead naked guy laying in the road. You have no hope. And Jesus comes to you in your dusty road and finds you in your brokenness, in your helplessness, and restores you to life at ultimate cost to himself, pays for it all, brings you into his family. And then you begin to realize, you look around, you say, there's a lot of people that were broken and lost that God has redeemed and called to himself. And we call that the church. And now these broken people who have been restored by Christ, God says, now there are other people lying in their own roadway that I'm sending you out to find. That's the heart of the mission of the church. It's the heart of our mission. I hope you hear that. The heart of our mission is not just launching a third campus, which we've talked a lot about. And I'm thrilled about what's happening at Mill Creek. We're praying for gospel impact to happen in that community and beyond because of that church, which will open in September. But the heart of the mission is not just a building. It's that every one of us who's been changed by the gospel of Jesus Christ would take seriously the call in our lives to love God with all our heart and soul and to love our neighbor as ourselves. We just think that will produce not a giant box somewhere, but neighborhood churches. So we can do this most effectively. It begins with personal impact. Impact in my life and through my life. Imagine with me for a minute in the story Jesus told. It was a story. It's a fictitious story, but he told a story that is being played out over and over again in many ways in reality. But this man the Samaritan saved, this nameless man lying in the roadway. Imagine he's an old man, years from now, and somebody asks him the question, who had the most profound influence on your life? What would he say? Well, my mom, she was great. My dad, he was great. Our local rabbi, he was kind of annoying, you know, whatever. But there was this Samaritan man. Let me tell you about him. Let me tell you about the man who saved my life and changed me forever. Do you think this man would be more generous or less after that experience? More compassionate or less? That's personal impact, meaning we are to be the ones saying, let me tell you about the one who changed my life. Let me tell you about the one who saved me. Let me tell you about the one who impacted me, and I'll never be the same. His name is Jesus. I want to introduce you to him. I want you to know about him because he's had the most profound impact on my life. That's the heart of this story. That's personal impact. Second, we move to neighborhood impact. Meaning, when I've been changed, the region and place in which I live, the people with whom I interact, ought to be impacted by what God is doing in my life. How many of you remember the old TV show, Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood? Show of hands, remember Mr. Rogers? Do you remember the theme song? Who remembers the theme song? Should we try to sing it together? You might see an image of Fred Rogers here. It's a beautiful day in the neighborhood. Come on, sing with me. A beautiful day for a neighbor, would you be mine? Could you be mine? I have always wanted to live in a neighbor, have a neighbor just like you. I've always wanted to live in a neighborhood with you, so come on, let's make the most of this beautiful day. Since we're together, you might as well say, would you be mine? Could you be mine? Won't you be my neighbor? Won't you please? Won't you please? Please won't you be my neighbor? Hi, neighbor, right? You remember that song? Some of you know it. You are the one to sing it. I hope you're blind yourselves. Okay, in addition to being a little bit creepy for this middle-aged man singing that song, I've been thinking about that. It does raise an important question. You know that line? I've always wanted to have a neighbor just like you. Okay, here's a question for you. Do the people that live next to you, your home on your street or an apartment, or that work in offices or desks next to you, or that have school desks next to you if you're a student, or that you ride the train with every day, you probably see the same people. The people that are around you on a daily basis, would they say that? Would they say, I've always wanted to have a neighbor like you? I've always wanted to have somebody near me like you and your family. Could they say that about you and about me? You'll see an image here on the screen of a grid of houses. Imagine that one that's filled in the middle is yours. Let's just begin here. How many of the people, right, the five people that are closest to you where you live, can you name? First and last name. You know their kids' names? If they have kids? Know anything about their lives? I've been doing this in my own life, right? I'm not going to make you answer it. We didn't put it in your bulletin. You don't have to do it. But if we're going to love, if Jesus says, love your neighbor as yourself, can we agree it begins by knowing their name? That's not hard, right? It begins there. Who are those people? A couple years ago, about 4 or 5 years ago, when I was driving home from church on a Sunday morning, after preaching and doing the thing, there was like a microburst storm. It was a bad storm and a microburst right near my neighborhood. Trees were down and winds were really strong, and right in front of us, about three cars in front of us, a tree fell over on the side of the road and hit the hood of a car that was driving real slowly along the road. You could hardly see. So I jumped out in the pouring rain with my oldest son. We helped get that tree off the car. They were all scared, but okay. And we got to our house, and it was like the center of a war zone. Trees down everywhere, fences down. And I have this old chainsaw that my dad used to own, and I never used it. I thought, ha ha, I got a chance now. So I put on my work clothes and went out in the neighborhood to try to help people because there were just branches everywhere, damage done to garage roofs and so forth. And I was out there for a couple of hours. Power was out and the whole thing. And I'm cutting up branches and helping these people. And I remember having the thought vividly going, who are all these people? Where do they come from? I've never seen them before. And they're three houses down, right? Because when we drive in my house, in my garage, and I close the garage door, you don't have to see me. I go inside my house, I go in my back deck. It's, you know, I don't have to interact with people. And now I'm out there helping them, and I don't even know who they are. You live there? Who knew? And then the lights came, the power came back on after a couple hours. And it was like a switch went, okay, good seeing you, gotta go. Right? Back into our houses. We live in an isolated culture. If we're gonna take seriously this gospel call to love God and love our neighbor, it begins by knowing who they are. Author Jill Savage wrote a blog post titled, The Lost Art of Neighboring and Porching. I didn't know what porching was. It's a verb, apparently. She says, the back deck in suburban America requires an invitation. If I come over to your house, I can't just walk around and open the gate, go in your backyard and get on your deck. You'd think I was an intruder. You have to invite me. But the front porch is itself an invitation. I love that. Whether or not you have a porch is not the point. Sadly, most of us, if we have a porch, it's for home resale value. We don't use it to love people. I tend to think of my house too often as like, it's a refuge from people. I'm with people all day long. I want to go home and sort of hide. How do you react when the doorbell rings at your house? Who's that? Selling something? Did you call somebody? Turn the lights off, right? Peek out the window? When I was a kid, it was different. We got excited. Years ago, when I was in Roseland, Tom and Mary mentioned this trip in Roseland in Chicago. When I was down there, we first started taking kids to the far south side. It's a pretty dangerous place. The tragedy that happened in St. Charles this weekend, that happens on a weekly basis in Roseland. We had work projects to do for people in the church and the community for reclaiming abandoned homes. And one lady named Miss Juanita Williams had us repaint her porch white every summer. It's a broken down house on a really dangerous street. Sad street, a lot of brokenness on that street. 103rd place, just off of Michigan Avenue, but a lot different than the Michigan Avenue you're familiar with. Way south. Anyway, she told us that she wanted us to paint. She's the lady who, when we first showed up there, stood there in her cotton dress and her slippers and said to some of our high school students, you want to see something? And they said, sure. And so she took our wig off, and she had a shiny bald head with a caved inside of her head where she'd had brain surgery. She said, the Lord saved me, like this, you know? And our kids were like, ah, you know? And the pastor who was with us said, listen, if a woman in this community says you want to see something, don't automatically say yes. Anyway, so I vividly remember this. I wrote this down because it was such a touching thing. She wanted us to paint her porch white every summer. And it would peel, and we'd have to do it again. And she stood there like in her slippers and her cotton dress, and she said, like a poem, she called it out. She goes, paint my porch white, y'all. Paint every step board and rail. I want all on this street to take notice that hope is alive and won't fail. She would say that over and over again, like a little song, you know? She said it better than I did. But it was her point was, there was a crack house three doors down. There's an abandoned house across the street. There was brokenness and pain all over that neighborhood. She wanted her house to be different. You know, this brokenness and pain in your neighborhood, too, just isn't as obvious as it is in Roseland. It's more hidden. She wanted her house to be a light, like a little chapel on her street, a place of prayer, a place of worship, a place that people recognized as there's something different about that family. That's what I want my house to be. It's not always that way, if I'm honest. The gospel calls us to be good neighbors, but it calls us to more than that. In the art of neighboring, that book that I read years ago, which has been so influential for many of us, there's a statement, every church should be a gift to its city and every Christ follower a gift to his or her street and neighborhood. One of the places in the Bible where this is idea of that you are to be not just a good neighbor, like a nice person, but a light to the hope of the gospel in your area that is so beautifully put is the Apostle Paul writes about it in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 18 through 20. Let me read that for us. Second Corinthians 5, verse 18. All this is from God, who through Christ reconciled us to himself and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting to us the message of reconciliation. Therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ. God making his appeal through us, we implore you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. I love that passage. God making his appeal through us. Gospel transformation and gospel impact are right in that passage, aren't they? We have been reconciled to God through Christ. That's transformation. And then we've been given the ministry of reconciliation. That's impact. Not just a message to share, but a life to embody that message. That's why when you're called an ambassador, you don't just share the message. You live it. You embody it. You represent it, the one who sent you. We are called ambassadors in that sense. God making his appeal through our lives. To be an ambassador means you are more than a messenger. You are the physical representation of the one who put you there, who sent you there. God making his appeal through your life. Your life is an appeal. Think about that for just a minute. Your life with Jesus Christ, my life with Jesus Christ, is to be an appeal to those who know me. It should be appealing. They should see in my life like a living invitation because of how much the love of Christ fills me and you. That's both thrilling to me and convicting to me. I get excited about that, and I also recognize that I don't always live up to it. We are to treat people as Jesus would treat them if he were living in your place. God, the word for appeal is the Greek word is parakaleo. It's also the same root word where we get the word for the Holy Spirit. It means one who comes alongside. And the verb part means that you are inviting alongside. In other words, to summon to oneself is a literal translation, the appeal. God is summoning people to himself. How? Through you. Through your life. When you go to work tomorrow, the way you treat people, customers, coworkers, people that share the office space with you, you go to school tomorrow, you interact with those that you just rub shoulders with all day long, God's making an appeal through our lives. Sometimes it's silent and subtle, sometimes it's obvious. But that's the truth. Let me ask this question, I've been asking it myself. What kind of invitation is your life? How inviting is your walk with Christ to those who know you? That's God's plan. It's beautiful, it's mysterious. Sometimes I wonder, God, couldn't there have been a better plan than us? But that's his plan. That's what the Apostle Paul said in Colossians chapter 1, verse 27. Christ in you is the hope of glory. Christ in you, the hope of glory. God's given us his word. And he's given the world us. That last line from chapter 5, verse 20, we implore you, we beg you, we beseech you, we urge you, be reconciled to God. That phrase, that word reconciled, and one of the great joys for me in pastoral ministry, it doesn't always happen, but one of my favorite things is when I get to interact with couples who their marriages are in real trouble. They're distant from each other. They're cold, distrustful, angry, hostility. And I see God and his grace over time turn hostility into harmony, turn distance into intimacy, turn anger and distrust into real love, and he brings them together. It takes work, it's not easy, but when I see that happen, that's such a beautiful picture of the gospel. You who are far away, Ephesians tells us, have been brought near. You who are strangers have become family members. You who are foreigners now become citizens. The gospel reconciles us to God. We're indifferent, cold, distant, hostile. And he brings us in. And he wants to do that through our lives. Finally, global impact. Meaning, we think about our lives, it's to be personal, regional in the neighborhood, and global. Back to that question we started with. Can you change the world, really? I mean, you're not a world-class philosopher or author or scholar or leader. Maybe some of you are, I just don't know about it yet. But can an average person change the world? We have the hope of the gospel, friends. We change the world not because we're really smart people. We change the world not because we have great ideas and we have lots of natural talent. We change the world because we take this seriously. The gospel really does change people. It has changed people. And if you don't know it's changed you, then you're not going to have that confidence. You remember the story of Amanda Good, right? Serving in Rwanda, meeting a little boy named Fred with one leg, whose dream was to walk and to go to school. That seemed impossible, but she thought, what could I do? And God, through her obedience just to love that kid, did a miracle. He's walking. He's going to school. He has friends. His village has been impacted. That's changing the world. Men and women from this church are serving God in Nigeria, Indonesia, Turkey, Czech Republic, Ukraine, Ecuador, Rwanda, and I could go on. Why? Why is that important? Because the gospel transforms people, and transformed people impact the world, right here and around the world. This is, I think, the most radical thought ever expressed. The most radical words ever uttered. They're not the ad slogan from Apple. Our love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, with all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. If we would do that, it would change the world. It is changing the world. That's what we're about as a church and why we're doing what we're doing. And you're going to see in a few moments a video that some of you may have seen before back in the beginning of this series. It lays out the vision for who we are as a church and where God is leading us and why he's leading us there. I want you to watch this video. And as you do, pray about, ask God, what is my part? What is the quality of my life as an invitation to those I interact with, as an appeal on behalf of God? What part can I play? And then I'll come back up in opportunity and we'll have a chance to celebrate God's provision through our generosity together. What I mean by that is, many of you know this, you're already prepared, I've talked to some of you, to make our contributions, our commitments to what God is doing in our midst and what he will do, our financial commitments. And if you're new here and you came at a very unique time, a very special time in the life of our church, we're glad you're with us. We don't want you to feel pressure to give. For now, I want you to watch this video and meditate on your part, then I'll come back up and lead us through our closing moment. You are here. But have you ever stopped to consider why you live in your neighborhood, on your street, or in your house? What if it's not just about meeting your needs, about good school systems, affordability, and proximity to your work? What if instead it's about the faces and names of your neighbors? What if it's less about you and more about impacting the lives of those around you? God has placed our church right where it is for the very same reason, so that together we can reach our neighbors for Christ. This is our neighborhood as a church, and it's home to more than 600,000 names and faces, and over 50% of them say they have no connection to a church at all. That is every other person you meet. They are the reason we are here. Since the opening of our West Campus, our ability to love and serve the neighbors within our reach has grown immensely. Our Shepherd's Heart Care Center started out as just a closet of extra food and now serves nearly 1,000 people every month. Our Masterpiece Ministries reach and serve dozens of families of children with special needs in our community. And our women's ministry is expanding rapidly, reaching more and more women, and they have outgrown our current facilities. We are increasingly becoming a church not for ourselves, but for our neighbors. And as we've grown, we've had to ask ourselves the question, is our greatest impact going to happen by building bigger and bigger facilities? Rather than investing in any one campus to make it significantly larger, we believe we must reproduce ourselves by strategically placing campuses in the communities we are already poised to reach. We are convinced that God is leading us toward becoming a family of neighborhood churches committed to transforming lives and impacting the world with the gospel of Jesus Christ. Neighborhood Impact is an initiative to strategically expand and multiply our gospel impact through establishing neighborhood churches. We have a goal to raise $6.2 million over the next 3 years. This money will be used to renovate and expand the Mill Creek campus, to renovate and improve our West campus, and to expand the capacity of Shepherd's Heart at our East campus. However, Neighborhood Impact means much more than just raising money or adding another facility. It means we must intentionally develop new leaders in all areas of ministry. We've already begun this through our Leadership Institute and are expanding it through the new Pastoral Residency Program. It also means developing new opportunities, keeping our eyes open for communities in need, and cultivating hearts of compassion that can see the opportunities emerging for gospel impact. Ministries like our Shepherd's Heart Food Pantry, Masterpiece Ministry, our support and care ministries have been reaching the unique needs of our neighbors, and we're only just beginning.
Most importantly, it means more people transformed by the gospel and committed to loving, serving, and reaching their neighbors for Christ. It means people like Laura and Jeff, who started a Bible study in their own neighborhood to reach those who are far from God, but right next door. It means men like Scott, who God has taken from a nominal churchgoer to a leader sold out to serving his community. And Christine, who came to us in a time of great brokenness and need, and now has a passion to impact the lives of others who are hurting. It means couples like Amanda and Nick, who experience the love of God's people reaching out to them during the toughest 48 hours of their lives. It means people like you. You see, we cannot do this without you. You are the gospel agent in your home, on your street, in your neighborhood. There are 300,000 people right around us who do not know the hope of the gospel. What could God do if everyone watching this committed to loving and serving their neighbors? This is what Neighborhood Impact is all about. It's about the gospel, the church, the neighborhood, and you.
I've seen that 50 times, and I don't get tired of it, even though it's the same voice I hear in my head all the time. That last line is so important. I hope you caught that. That the vision is about each one of us playing our part, each one of you playing your part. What would you have me give, God? What would you have me do, God? Now the ushers are coming to pass these out. If you have one and you're ready, just pass the stack by. And if you're not ready, that's fine too. But in case you need one, the ushers are going to pass these over around. You know, we don't have the opportunity very often in our culture to make public declarations of our faith. We do it at weddings. We do it at baptisms. This isn't really, I believe, a collective opportunity for us to declare our intent before God, what we're willing to do to contribute to see His work go forward. Your commitment cards should indicate your total financial contribution over the next 3 years, whatever that ends up being. And I hope you hear me say this from the bottom of my heart. What matters is that we're in for this vision. The dollar amount is between you and God. If it's $1, put it down. And if you still need time and you're praying, but you know in your heart you want to be part of this, then I would encourage you, just write down still praying and fill it in and write down the amount part still praying. Let us know that when you're ready. If you're a guest here again, you came at a unique time. We don't do this very often. It's a special time. And we don't want you to feel pressure at all to come forward. Over the past few weeks, several members of our church family have already told me that how God's moved in their hearts, and they're already not only ready to pledge, but making contributions. I want you to know that your leadership, my family, our senior leadership team and their families, our executive council, our ministry staff are in for this, have already decided what their part is going to be as well. In just a moment, I'm going to pray and give us a chance, but I want you to look over here at this cross and this map. That map is the combination of both campuses, all the dots that you've been placing throughout the last few weeks. That's our church family. That's our neighborhood. You can see both the great opportunity and potential we have to make an impact and some of the open spaces where God might lead us in the future. But I love the fact that the shadow of the cross falls over our neighborhood. You have to look through the cross to see our neighborhood. That's the heart of what this is, to bring the hope of the gospel to every city, every neighborhood, every street, every family, and every life. That will change the world. And toward that end, we need to play our part, all of us. So after I've prayed, and if you're ready, you can go up as a couple, as a family, or as an individual, and place your contribution, your commitment card, in those crates that are at the foot of the cross there, and return to your seat. And once we've all had a chance to do that, if it's in our heart to do so, we'll worship God as we close. And again, I don't want you to feel obligated or guilty, just an opportunity to publicly say, I'm in for this, God. I want to be part of what you're doing here. I want to make my commitment. Now, I want to close us, or prepare us, I guess, by offering this prayer from King David in 2 Chronicles chapter 29. This is the prayer he prayed over God's people when they built the very first temple. And I think it's beautiful because this is a sacred moment for us. Let's pray. O Lord God, who am I and who are these people that we should be able to give as generously as this? Everything we have comes from you, and we have only given you what comes from your hand. Praise be to you, O Lord, God of our father Israel, from everlasting to everlasting. Yours, O Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory and the majesty and the splendor. For everything in heaven and earth is yours. Yours is the kingdom. You are exalted as head over all. Wealth and honor come from you. You are the ruler of all things. In your hands are strength and power to exalt and give strength to all. Now, our God, we give you thanks. We give you our gifts and we praise your glorious name. Amen. Amen. As Ali sings, the band plays, you may come as you're ready. I really can't tell you what a humbling experience it was to watch you, God's people, come before him and say, we want to make the greatest impact we can with the time you've given us as this part of your church in the world. I thank you and we praise God. Let me leave you now with a benediction. If you're, by the way, in need of any prayer for any reason, as always, members of the prayer team will be down front. We'd love to encourage you through prayer. But now, brothers and sisters, go in the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, who is with you and for you, and because of him, nothing can come against. Amen, and go in peace.